Welcome to Take Good Care Podcast,
an endeavor that grew out of our love for obstetrics and gynecology. Our aim and mission is to serve as a source of vital information for women of all races, ages, and walks in life.
I am Dr. Miranda Williams.
I am Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green.
Welcome to our show. Welcome to this episode of Take Good Care Podcast. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green.
On today's episode, we're going to be talking about something that's been in the news a lot recently, and even more so the last few years, is about the good and the bad surrounding a four-day work week. Our practice enjoys now having a four-day work week. And our journey to starting this four-day work week really happened more so because of a need to achieve work-life balance for us at the time. So it was really about a work-life balance decision for us as women and physicians, professionals with family at the time, you know, younger kids, aging parents, you know, all those kinds of things. Also, we found that we had several staff members who had been working with us for long periods of time who had set days off. They may be off on a Tuesday or maybe off on a Thursday or maybe had a Monday off. And then we found ourselves having to either hire or do all kinds of crazy things to cover on the days when those individuals were not here. So because of a lot of the market pressures and even the demographic shifts that occurred, that were occurring at that time, along with, admittedly, I was becoming extremely burned out at the time. I just felt very depleted. It was just a very difficult time in life, as well as with the work on top of that. And I was really beginning to make a decision to leave obstetrics on my own. And we were trying to figure out, you know, do we add another position? You know, what? How do we make this work? Because we were delivering babies, taking call. So there was a lot going on. So in true fashion, the way that the three of us typically do things after we shifted through all of that, made the decision as a group to retire from obstetrics, which we will talk about maybe in another episode. Instead of just one person retiring from obstetrics in the practice, we all retired from obstetrics in the practice.
It was Shut it down.
All for one and one for all. So when we retired from obstetrics in the middle of 2016, at that time, we had about five providers working with us. And then because of different circumstances, we ended up transitioning back down to the three ladies that you see now and that you're hearing from. And that happened in the middle of 2017. And then it was shortly after that when we were down to just the three of us, no longer doing obstetrics, but still having to juggle a number of things, including the staffing challenges that came with other individuals who were working with us having a day off. We elected to convert to a four-day work week, and that was in the September of 2017. And we presented it to the staff. We were a little concerned because we weren't quite sure how they were going to think about this and how this was going to work, but we knew we had to do something. So we did, you know, presented it to our staff and told them that this is what we needed to do for our longevity and then for the longevity of the practice. So we made the transition in 2017 to a four-day work week, and we have not looked back since. And then, of course, we all know what happened in, at least in the United States, in the spring of 2020, the world stopped. So I think that episode of time that we've been all experiencing has kind of caused a resurgence in the conversation about working and work-life balance and different things. So we thought this would be a good time to kind of look at the pros and cons of a four-day work week, probably share some of our experiences and then some of the other information that we read on. So we'll begin today's discussion with Dr. Guthrie. She's going to go into some of the, again, the history and concepts behind a four-day work week. Dr. Green is going to pick the discussion up, giving some information on four-day work week models. And then I'll come back with some more thoughts about pros and cons of everything regarding a four-day work week and perhaps other alternatives. And we'll just have a conversation just to see how everything goes. Dr. Guthrie.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. So as you've heard Dr. Williams say many times, in doing this podcast, you know, our primary goal is to provide relevant, reliable, and relatable information, and not only for our listeners and our viewers, but for ourselves. And so a lot of these topics that are forefront in the news, you know, we want to bring them to you for discussion and to kind of give, if it was relevant to us, kind of what happened with us and how we went through that process. Mm-hmm. So as Dr. Williams said, there was recent studies about a British study that looked at the 4-day work week and what that would entail, and if this could be something that could be possibly enacted in it as on a broad scale. Mm-hmm. Again, part of all this discussion is about as we season. That's my word instead of getting older. As we season. You know, like work-life balance becomes very, very important. Like you said, there are children, elderly parents, where you are in your career, as you've built up in your career. And sometimes all these factors together can be very hard to navigate and can even become unsustainable. Mm-hmm. So, you know, being obstetricians, that schedule in and of itself, mm-hmm. for a lot of people, they would consider unsustainable, but yeah. Somehow you just do it. You just, you know. And for obstetrics, mm-hmm. the call schedule is life. Mm-hmm. Like there's the call schedule, and then there's your life, how it fits into the call mm-hmm. schedule. Because mm-hmm. any change made by one physician affects the other physicians.
If you're sharing calls.
If you're sharing calls. Mm-hmm. And so, but a lot of group practices, that's what they do. Mm-hmm. And so, again, when we were looking at this season in our life, that was part of the impetus for us to make changes. And not only did we make a change in the number of days we worked a week, we made some other changes too. Like we closed one week during the Christmas holiday. Mm-hmm. Because throughout our lives, holidays and celebrations didn't mean much because mm-hmm. like somebody had to work. Somebody mm-hmm. always had to work. Mm-hmm. And time off had to be planned well in advance. For me, this change that we've made has been a blessing. It's been wonderful. Mm-hmm. But then we had the pandemic.
Yeah.
Okay. And that did shed a big light on what was important, you know. So a lot of people found out that the things that they thought were just absolutely necessary in their lives, like things that they could not do, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. when you couldn't do it, guess what? Did you really need to do all of that, right? You know, you could live without all those things. Mm-hmm. During the pandemic, the job market received a huge shakeup that they said is unprecedented, mm-hmm. and it's still continuing, mm-hmm. you know. So, of course, at the beginning of the pandemic, because everything was closing down, there was a lot of job loss because people were being laid off, you know, businesses were going under because of, you know, no revenue during this short period of time when everything had to be shut down. Mm-hmm. But then you would think that that would continue, but guess what? All of a sudden we are at the lowest unemployment rate in history. Mm-hmm. Brian Michael Jenkins, he's written this book called Plagues and Their Aftermath. Hmm. He looked at all the different plagues that happened throughout history and how it affected society. Mm-hmm. So the first one he looked at, of course, was the bubonic plague, or called the Black Death, mm-hmm. where they lost almost half of the population in right. Europe. So when that happened, there were no people to plant and harvest mm-hmm. and do all the menial jobs that the aristocracy needed. Mm-hmm. So after that recovery, they had better strength in negotiating payment, work, mm-hmm. things like that.
They were essential workers.
They were essential workers. There you go. That's what it was. And they even had a revolt called the Peasants' Revolt in 1381, just demanding better pay, mm-hmm. better conditions, things like that. Mm-hmm. There were also effects seen after there was a cholera outbreak. And then, of course, the most recent one was 100 years ago, which was the mm-hmm. the flu epidemic. Mm-hmm. So with this pandemic, something happened called the Great Resignation. Mm-hmm. And that's a term that Anthony Klotz, who's a psychologist, kind of penned for what happened. Other names that they have for it is called the Big Quit. or the Great Reshuffle. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so what they were seeing was in the initial stages of the pandemic, a lot of people, because people were losing jobs and they didn't know what was going to happen, mm-hmm. people who were even going to retire or change jobs kind of mm-hmm. held off because they were like, hey, I don't know what's going to happen. Sure, yeah. I may need a job. Let me hold on. Mm-hmm. That sort of thing. But then as the pandemic kept going and then as job situations were changing, in the middle of the pandemic in 2021, 47 million, let me say that number mm-hmm. again, 47 million people quit their jobs.
Mm. Wow.
Now, the majority of these people were women. They found yeah. that the majority were women. Mm-hmm. And it had to do with now the kids were home. The kids weren't going anywhere. Who was going to take care right. of the children? Who was going right. to take care of the home? That sort of thing. Mm-hmm. They even, in one article, they even linked it to, they said Beyonce was kind of responsible for the revolution with her song, Break My Soul. So they even tied it to Beyonce's song, you know, you're not going to break my soul. I'm going to step back. I don't need this job. I'm going to do what's important to me. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. There were also the lower paying jobs and the less skilled workers were also the ones that suffered a lot, especially in the retail and hospitality mm-hmm. Industries. So restaurants, stores, things like that. Mm-hmm. A lot of people quit because the pay yeah. wasn't, you know, it was now highlighting like minimum wage issues and mm-hmm. things like that. Mm-hmm. And so this was another key factor in why people just quit. And it's even now people. You can't find a person.
It's hard to find mm-hmm. people to work.
You know? What was the meme that you just sent us? It's like, please, looking
now
for.
Now hiring for people who show
now
up.
Now hiring people who show up.
Just show up
to the job.
Any other qualifications. Right? Can you just show up?
Another big factor was working from home. Mm-hmm. And that became an eye opener. Think jobs where, again, you would never think I'd have to go in every day, go through the traffic, spend the money on the gas. Mm-hmm. Now when people are. Things are opening back up. People are demanding that they still work from home at least part of the time.
Have that option.
Right. And have that option. Mm-hmm. It's a key factor in retaining people. Mm-hmm. Sectors that offered work from home saw fewer resignations than the others who did not. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then 30% of workers now say if working from home is not a factor, they will consider leaving their job. Mm-hmm. They did an interview with Kevin O'Leary, what's his name? Mr. Wonderful, is that what he calls himself? He's Shark Tank guy. Kevin O'Leary.
Oh, that guy. Okay.
44% of the workforce is now remote and not coming in. Mm-hmm. And for a lot of younger workers, this is what you have to now realize, as with anything, this is all they know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, going to work every day, putting on clothes, mm-hmm. getting dressed, all mm-hmm. that stuff is not, they don't know anything about mm-hmm. that. So when you're now trying to demand that they do that, they're like, no, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So now employers are having to reshape job descriptions to fit, you know, the new way of looking at things. Mm-hmm. Also want to take, before we go into the 4-day work week, take a look at the history of the traditional work week. The 5-day work week that we have now it's not even 100 years old. Mm-hmm. So if we think that that's what it's been throughout time, no, it has not. People worked pretty much 6 to 7 days a week mm-hmm. in the past. Mm-hmm. In the late 1800s, it started with British factories, started giving half a day on Saturdays, mm-hmm. In addition to everybody rested on Sunday. But then they started with this half a day Saturday. It didn't become fully adopted until here in the United States with the Ford Motor Company when he had mm-hmm. the assembly lines. Mm-hmm. The first 2-day weekend in the United States was adopted actually in an American mill in 1908. And then, like I said, when the Ford Motor Company, they trialed it in July of 1926, and it was full policy by September. Mm-hmm. So it was something that they just saw the benefits mm-hmm. right away. Mm-hmm. Because it showed such benefits, it then became federal law. So the Fair Labor Standards in 1938 guaranteed a minimum wage of 25 cents. And a 44-hour work week. Right. And then they
minimum
also...
Minimum wage what?
25 cents. 25 cents an hour. And a 44-hour work week. Mm-hmm. And then they had to pay time and a half for overtime. Well, seeing the benefits of that, it changed again in 1939. The work week became 42 hours. And then the now 40-hour work week started in 1940. So Andrew Barnes, who's part of this four-day work week revolution, his statement is, the five-day week is a 19th century construct that is not fit for purpose in the 21st century.
It's true.
And so this is why a lot of places are now looking into these four-day work weeks and how they work and pros and cons of how they work. Mm-hmm. So now Dr. Green is going to tell us, how do you do this four-day work week and what are the ways that you can implement it with your jobs?
Thank you, Dr. Guthrie. It's interesting because we had done it, I really didn't know, you know, what there were in terms of other forms. And so it was interesting reading the articles to talk about, you know, what, you know, how to do a four-day work week, how we're going to do it. The thing, of course, we came across was, I think we are all used to working 5 days a week. You know, most people, 5 days, 40 hours. Now, for obstetricians, it was a lot longer than that. So for us, you know, 5 days, 40 hours seemed like a big deal. That was a benefit. It's like, wow, we only have to work 5 days a week for 40 hours and sometimes take call. So 4 days was a big change. And our staff was like, well, how is that going to work? Am I going to make less money? You know, what's this going to work? You know, how am I going to figure this out? And so there actually are two different forms of a four-day work week. One's called the compressed form. So actually employees work 10 hours for 4 days instead of 8 hours for 5 days. So they're still getting their 40 hours a week. Because for most employees, their concern is, if I'm going to make less money, that's going to be a problem because I'm used to making a certain amount and I want to get my 40 hours in. And so for employees that have that concern, looking at that type of form may be a benefit. The other one is shorter working duration. So instead of working the 40 hours a week, you're actually only working 32 hours. So you get that nice 3-day weekend, the Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or the Saturday, Sunday, Monday. They kind of decide which day is going to be the day off. And Dr. Williams will talk about the benefits of having those 3 days off. I think we all can feel the benefits, but there's actual data, you know, that goes to talk about what there are in terms of benefits. Of course, the problem is, how are we going to do that? So when it comes to looking at the different models, you have to first determine, what's the goal? You know, why are you making the change? As Dr. Williams said, we looked at, you know, why were we going to make this change? And for us, it was a lot of different reasons that factored into that. But is it, when you make the change, is it going to improve efficiency? Is it going to boost productivity? Is it going to add to retention of your staff? And then looking at other areas, are there areas that need to be addressed before you actually implement it? How is this going to be scheduled? How are the benefits going to be determined? And of course, payroll. Payroll is going to see the most changes just in terms of if you're suddenly working 10-hour days versus 8-hour days, or you're suddenly working 32 versus 40 hours. And then looking at the team, asking their advice, asking to say, you know, what do you think about this? Are you interested? Do you have any alternatives? Ideally, you want to see. And I think for smaller businesses like ours, you really could ask the team and talk to them about, you know, what do you see as a benefit? And as we've said, for us, people had a day off. And so people getting a guaranteed day off is something that a lot of people thought, well, that actually might be a good idea. Maybe I can get some stuff done. You know, for me personally, it was wonderful. Just as Dr. Guthrie said, it was like a breath of fresh air that I had a whole day to say, I can do all these wonderful things that I don't get to do, or I have to schedule and fit in between my pre-call, on-call,
or,
post-call.
In my case, I can do nothing.
Yes. And that not too. Tell anybody that I have the day off.
I can just have a day to do nothing.
And not tell anybody that I have the day off. Which is the one thing that I'm jealous about with Dr. Williams. I wish I had not told anyone that I had that day off, so I had the whole day to myself.
Because now they're going to fill it up with stuff.
Because people do fill your days up with stuff. Mm-hmm. But for, you know, a lot of people, they do have stuff they need to do. And trying to get things done on the weekend can be difficult because most businesses still work during the week. You know, so if you have a doctor's appointment, or if you got to take the child somewhere, if you've got a child outing that you want to go to, I mean, there are things that you would like to be able to do, and having that scheduled day off actually allows you to do that. Mm-hmm. Policy needs to be clear. You know, if you make a change in your office, how are we going to implement this? You know, what exactly, they're going to be clear determinations around the different protocols. What will change and what will remain the same? Some people may not be a good fit. If you need to produce items 4 days, 5 days a week, taking 4 days may take a hit if you're only doing 32 hours. And so looking at those type of productivity change, and I think that, you know, we looked at that, and because we made the change when we were just seeing gynecologic patients as opposed to obstetrical patients, looking at, do we need to add more patient slots so we can see the same number of patients that we would see in 5 days? Some days it feels like we see the same number of patients, but looking at that in terms of, you know, what the numbers. And of course, highlighting the intended advantages. So if you're going to make the transition, what are the advantages? Obvious advantages should be the main point of the plan, so that if people know that these are the advantages of doing the 4-day work week, they're more apt to say, well, if I get the day off and actually I'm going to feel better because if I have a 3-day weekend, I'm going to like this. Because if you promote the idea of a 4-day work week, however you promote it, and promote it with a positive attitude as opposed to, you know, we're making this change because we want to make this change, we're making this change because it will benefit you, then more people are apt to really, decide that they want to do it. Of course, then you have to determine the schedule, the working hours, who works and who has days off. Is this going to affect everybody? Is everybody going to have the same day off, or are you going to have an alternate day off? So some people are going to work Monday through Thursday and other people are going to work Tuesday through Friday. And how's that going to affect your schedules? How's that going to affect, you know, your office staff? How's that going to affect people, you know, in our case, checking in patients? And of course, for a lot of people, when they did the different testings in other companies, they tested the system first. And as Dr. Guthrie pointed out, they did a test on a system long time ago and realized that the benefits were so easy to see. Well, obviously, we need to do this. We need to make that change. And then you may want to consider a part-time option, that only certain times of the year would 4 days make sense. So maybe on your low times where you're not making as much product or you're not seeing as many patients, you know, this would be the time of the year that we should work 4 days. And then, of course, how is this going to impact paid time off and sick leave? Because the other thing other than employee salaries, employees think about is how much time am I going to get off? You know, what time do I get off? Is this going to have rules regarding FMLA or federal and state law? So we have to look at those type of things before we implement it. There are definitely companies around the world that already have 4-day work weeks. Amazon is one. Kickstart is another. E-file Cabinet, Perpetual Guardian, Buffer, and Nighty. The ones that, of course, we think of course, of Amazon and Kickstarter, but they've seen the benefit. And as we've talked, that this is something that people are looking at since the pandemic. They're looking at, you know, what's important.
Or they're looking at it more. You know, they've always kind of looked at it.
But, you know, yeah. And I think the pandemic really, as we said, highlighted the fact that people would like to have, you know, some time to themselves, you know, even if it's just to do nothing, but having that, you know, time to renew and refresh and go back to work the next week actually makes a difference in terms of productivity. And so some of the pros and the cons is something that Dr. Williams will address.
Well, actually, I'm going to do something a little different because I think, you know, again, when we started this whole concept of doing the podcast, and the reason the podcast is named Take Good Care is that, you know, I really want to talk about this more than just looking at pros and cons and that kind of thing, because every industry is different. I think my partners have already outlined reasons why it can work. There are reasons why it doesn't work as well, depending on the type of industry that you're in. If you're producing a product, a physical product, as they have mentioned, then in order to keep up with demands that your product may be needed, I think we're all suffering from the supply chain issues that now, and because everything is so integrated, if you're producing a portion of something that someone else needs to finish their part of that product, then you may have to keep up a certain schedule in order to meet demand. So, you know, I think some of the key takeaways that we've all talked about is that the idea behind a 4-day work week is that you're trying to achieve the same results in fewer hours so that people have more time to pursue other interests, spend time with loved ones, and to manage your lives. I think in the capitalist system that we're in, we kind of get caught on this hamster wheel that work more, make more, work more, make more, work more, make more. And yeah, you can make a lot of money and then you could die because you're burnt out and then take care of your health and then your kids will spend your money. You know, so it's like you have to remember, that, again, as Dr. Green was mentioning, the reasons for doing it. And then I just want to take it back home a little bit. We eventually worked out those things that Dr. Green has been talking about in terms of the policies and the procedures, because I'm policy procedure girl. So we worked all that out. But again, you know, what I want to highlight is that this was done. We tell people every time, this really wasn't a business decision for us. We didn't look at it and said, you know what, I think we can be more efficient as a staff and maybe even see more patients because we're only working in 4 days. That ain't what we did. We were looking at the fact that our staffing was being challenged because, again, physicians, we don't punch a clock. So I'm not punching in for an 8-hour day, and that's how I'm being compensated. But our staff, of course, some of them are hourly employees. Some are salaried, some are hourly. So they need to maintain a certain number of hours to make sure their income hits a certain level so they can support their families and their lifestyle. But what was happening is we've been blessed to have very long tenured employees. And so as they have worked for us for, in some cases, decades, they've amassed time off, you know, and so they take their time off. Or we have some staff who at that time didn't need to work as many hours to support their families. So they worked a 3-day work week, you know, but nobody had the same day off. Mm-hmm. Right. So we had some that was off on Monday. We had some that was off on Wednesday. We had somebody that was off on Friday. And invariably, we here every day, mm-hmm. you know, and we're seeing patients all day. And then I'll be like, oh, I need somebody to do such and such and such. Oh, you know, it's her day off.
Mm-hmm. I need to post the surgery.
Oh, the day off. And I'm like, okay. So that's why it wasn't efficient for us.
Yeah.
We were losing efficiency because we just had, there was no coordination with who had days off. That was a real huge piece of it. On top of work-life balance issues, no longer doing obstetrics, being in the office more, actually seeing patients. So it's not like we didn't add appointments. We were just here more, you know, because we weren't running to the hospital to do deliveries. And because we were trying to maintain our health, we didn't work the day after call, you know, or we only worked a half day after call. So because we were, in essence, out of the office a half day anyway, mm-hmm. you know, depending on how many call days you took. So by the fact of us just being able to be in the office at that time, 5 days a week, we had appointment slots. We were just here more. So it was really the efficiency of saying, well, we're here every day and we're seeing patients every day and patients have the same needs every day in terms of needing labs drawn, needing ultrasounds done, needing mammograms performed, needing surgeries scheduled, then we had to come up with a way to make it work for us. And so what the decision was, is like, hey, everybody needs a day off. You know, so we weren't mad about the days off. We were just saying, well, we got to work. So let's think about this. Why don't we all work Monday through Thursday and everybody have Friday off?
And they did mention that in one of the articles and how to choose your template mm-hmm. for a 4-day work week. They mm-hmm. were saying that when they recognizing that people do need time off, when it was sporadic like that, mm-hmm. trying to get a meeting mm-hmm. scheduled because can't hold a meeting on Tuesday. Mm-hmm. She's off on Tuesday, mm-hmm. but she's off on Thursday. Mm-hmm. And then depending on what kind of business you have, that was the one that was the least successful mm-hmm. because it was so sporadic mm-hmm. as we mm-hmm. tested yeah, and found out to. And can testify to. Mm-hmm. So
mm-hmm. absolutely. Mm-hmm. So when we did that, and again, we buy-in is so key. And I think it's important what you were saying, Dr. Green, whether you're a large company, small company, if you don't present issues and communicate transparently, mm-hmm. you know, to your leadership as well as your employees, whatever you decide is not going to work well, mm-hmm. you know. So I think communicating, and we're always very transparent with our staff, we and our leadership. We don't hold back from them, you know. And they see how we work, you know. And so when we sat down and started having conversations with them, like, we think we need to do this, and here's why we need to do this. You know, when you explain your why to people in almost any circumstances, it helps everyone to get on board with it because it's like, yeah, that makes sense. I feel the same way too. And that's, we are a company owned by women, run by women, for women. So So it wasn't a hard sell. You know, it wasn't like we had to convince anybody.
Because we all had the same challenges.
Right. You know, Everybody had the same challenges. They were like,
young kids, aging parents, all of that.
Friday's off. I'm still going to get my hours in. And that was one of the things that we really emphasized, is that we're not saying, because that's one of the downsides to some of the issues with 4-day work weeks. Because there are some companies who are trying to pay less.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are some companies who are shifting to 4-day work weeks, and because they do want to decrease the amount of money they're having to spend on staff salaries and benefits and those kinds of things.
But they still want the same amount of
they
work.
They still want the same amount of work.
5-day mm-hmm. week. That's...
And so we wanted our staff to continue to make their time. And believe me, they make their time because we are humping
before
Monday through Thursday.
Yes, yeah.
And then on Friday, we out. And it has really made the efficiency of our practice so much better, because we can take care of the patients the same way every day. And I think that was one of the reasons we were confused. I'm like, well, I don't want to have to do something different on Monday than I did on Wednesday because somebody isn't here.
Mm-hmm. Or the staff having to figure it out when they're scheduling somebody. Somebody's coming in for pain, but she may not have an ultrasound. She's going to have to come back for an ultrasound, which is not efficient.
Not efficient.
And
in some cases, safe
right.
for patient care.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there are companies who benefit because of the increased satisfaction of their staff. There are companies who could benefit through increased sales, decreased worker burnout, lower turnover, as we've already talked about, among positives. Again, emphasizing results instead of hours logged can sometimes help companies restructure how they pay their staff, because you're paying them for the results of what you need, whatever those results are, the number of bags of potato chips they're filling or whatever, instead of necessarily limiting it to you only work this amount of hours. Well, if I'm giving you the same results that you need, company owner, you know, to hit your bottom line, but I'm only here 32 hours a week to do that, the amount of productivity that you're getting is the same, so your salary does not have to necessarily decrease by that.
And that's
a lot of companies
are talking
about that.
For people when they want to stay home.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm giving you the same results, you know, and I'm probably a little more productive if I don't have to go in and fight the traffic. Calculate the traffic going back home.
Right.
You know, if I could just stay home Mondays and Fridays when the traffic's the worst.
Or the distractions of the things that then pull you away from work at times.
Exactly.
The kids, school, whatever. One kid is sick, you know, that sort of thing.
All that balance.
Mm-hmm.
I think they looked at, was it Google, where they don't set what hours they have to work?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the the number of hours. But like you said, it's more project management focused. So like I said, in Google, they could come in, they could work from 2 to 4 a.m. if they wanted to, long as, you know, nobody's making them work from 2 to 4 a.m. But if that person wanted to do something during the day and said, listen, I'm going to get my work done at this time, at the end, whenever they give, you know, due dates for projects, by June 25th, we need to have this, and this.
You mean your deadline.
And that's how the millennials or the newer kids, that's how they work now. That's how they think. The whole punching a clock. I think time clocks are going to be kind of...
Well, it's just like we've said, you know, it's those of us who are used to a certain way of working, we think that's the way it's always been. But you all have already talked about, no, this isn't how it's always been.
Right.
It's how it's always been during our lifetime, you know, in our parents' lifetime. But that was another one of the key takeaways. They talked about the pros and cons. It's like whatever a company or an individual decides to do, it's really about a major shift in how we think about and approach work.
Mm-hmm.
Because the environment that we're working in now is different than the environment of 100 years ago. Technology is different than it was 100 years ago. So you can be somewhere else and still get work done in a lot of instances. So because of that, we have to change how we think. And then we can figure out the best way to do it. And we're in the process of looking at, and again, just to reintroduce ourselves, we've been yapping here for a while. Thank you for listening to Take Good Care Podcast. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I'm Dr. Karen Green.
So just so you know who we are, And don't forget why we're here. And I just lost my train of thought. What were we talking about?
Well, just the different, how working is working, different thing, now. Thing and you can work from anywhere. Right. You can do, you know.
But also that we're in a transition in our practice. We're thinking about doing some things differently. And so as we've thought about doing some things differently, it's gotten a little uncomfortable. But we realize it doesn't mean that what we're talking about doing is a bad thing. It's just different.
Yeah, it's changed.
But do the circumstances now that we're looking at say that is something we should look at doing? Mm-hmm. Because you can't keep doing the same thing the same way all the time. Right. Because life changes, people change, needs change, you know, technology changes. And in our cases, you know, what patients may need change, how they want things done change. For instance, we send people home now same day for a lot of major surgeries because we don't do hysterectomies now the way we did them 25 years ago when we started doing this, you know. So
I'm looking for the at-home, the remote pap.
Forget that. Forget that, Dr.
But
Gretchen.
I can do a pap smear from home.
Believe me.
If I Zoom.
We will be retired. We will be retired by the time they've developed these little bitty drones. I can already see it in my mind. They're going to have these little bitty drones that they're going to be flying into places they probably don't need to fly to collect whatever that is to collect.
Zoom pap. That's what I'm going to call it. Zoom pap.
My mindset is not going to be able to handle that. So that's when I go to the house. Because I don't want to be home piloting a little drone trying to get it to go collect pap. I don't want to do that. So we're going to leave that to the young folks.
The young folks. Or
the younger.
Younger, yeah.
The younger folks, because we're still young.
But the point is things evolve and things change. Mm-hmm. And I think that it has changed so rapidly probably in the last 10 years.
Well, no, really more in the last 3 to 4 years, I think, because that is what the pandemic did.
Yeah, pushed
the
us.
Pandemic accelerated the digital revolution.
Yeah.
Because it had to. Mm-hmm. We did it in our office. We didn't do virtual visits. We were thinking about it. We were talking, oh, well, maybe that's something nice to do and da 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 until life shut down and we didn't have any other way to talk to our patients. So we said, oh, we got to get some technology in here. We got to figure out a way to make this work because we still got to take care of our patients in a safe fashion. And again, as gynecologists, we can't do everything virtually.
Until we get those little mini drones.
I'm not going to be flying no drone in any parts.
But even sending patients home the same day for a major surgery, I mean, that was a big
huge
deal.
Shift. But it was a mental shift.
It was very mental, very mental. And I think that patients have benefited from it. They really have.
Absolutely.
And it's just kind of pushed us in that direction so that patients are... It's safer, you know, for a lot of circumstances. I mean, you know, and as always, the three of us really evaluate a lot of stuff before we kind of jump headfirst into it. The pandemic probably pushed us a little quicker to doing some things we probably would have already done. But, you know, I think it's a good thing, you know. So any change that we're thinking about and talking about, we know we've done it before. It's been a good thing. And, you know, we'll move into it.
And if it's not a good thing, you learn. You know, I've enjoyed taking a certificate course through the E. Spelman Learning Program. And one of the topics that it talks about is the concept of design thinking. And in design thinking, one of the components is you just try stuff, right? You just try stuff. And they call it prototyping. So if you try this and it doesn't quite work out, oh, well, that prototype wouldn't work. Let's make a change on the prototype. It's just like phones. They make the example of phones. Well, we have iPhones. Some of us don't. But it's just like those of us who enjoy Apple products. The iPhone that I have now is not the iPhone that we had even 3 years from now because they keep making improvements. They keep making improvements. And things that work well, you continue. Things that don't work well, you tweak it, change it, and you keep it moving. So change is inevitable. How we approach change and accept change, I think, defines how successful it is. And so the same thing is true when individuals or companies or industries are thinking about changes in how we work, a 4-day work week being an example of that. Again, the benefits of a 4-day work week is that the fundamental goal of the 4-day work week is to improve the worker's quality of life. We did it to improve our quality of life, but we also did not want to impact our staff. you know, in our leadership team. By working fewer hours overall, and in our case, especially having 3 full days off, people usually have more time for their own personal priorities. Spending quality time with family, friends, pets, caregiving, doctor's appointments, personal development, taking courses, education, travel, hobbies, home maintenance. Mm. I've discovered I have a nice house.
Because you now see it.
Because I'm now there more. I'm like, oh, it's kind of nice here.
You know, the things that you need to get done here. That you keep saying you were going to do all this whole time. You kept pushing, kicking the can.
Now you can do that. So your household management becomes better. So, you know, there are different strategies. I think that companies, you know, medically related or not, has been talked about that can help you succeed making a change to something like a four-day work week strategy. Again, you want to prioritize and then reevaluate the tasks. As you're saying, what really needs to get done and when does it need to get done?
Because you did it every day on a Wednesday, does it still need to be every day on a Wednesday?
Exactly. You want to minimize interruptions and distractions so that the time that you are in your office or your workspace is productive. You want to increase automation, as we were saying, technology. I tell folks, don't be afraid of technology. Technology is a tool. Just learn how to use it. Use it for what you want and what you don't want. Don't worry about it. You want to emphasize human creativity. When you do reduce, and we've got to work on this, when you do reduce your work week, you need to limit work-based social events. We like to party. So, you know, we may have to work on that a little bit. You do want to reduce and shorten meetings. Now, we do meet a lot, but one of the things I try to do is like, listen, this is the agenda. This is what we need to do. We're going to start at this time. When I'm watching the clock, I'm like, okay, we got 10 more minutes. Let's get this done because we got to keep it moving. So you want to reduce and shorten meetings where you can. Spend less time on email and messaging. You want to define clear goals. You want to set goals that are achievable in a shorter work week. It's like, don't set yourself up to fail. Mm-hmm. If you know you're working in 4 days and you can only accomplish X number of things in 4 days, don't try to get 10 things done. It just doesn't make sense. You want to measure outcomes, not hours. And I think, you know, we had a situation too where we, you know, had, you know, there are individuals who are talking about, you know, I'm working all the time, working all the time, working all the time. Well, I can't see what you're doing. I'm not seeing results of what you're doing. So that's why they say let's measure the outcome, because the hours worked don't really matter if you're not getting the goal, if you're not getting your target, hitting your project. You want to maintain employee pay, as we tried to do. Even though we're reducing your hours, we're not trying to reduce your salary. We're not trying to pay you less. We just want to be here less but work smarter, not harder. You trust your people. You know, trust your workers, trust your team, you know, they will figure it out and usually come up with ideas you never would have thought of how to stay efficient.
There are a lot of businesses where, like you said, it's 15-minute breaks and and only 2 bathroom breaks. It's, you know, thinking that that's being efficient when if a person's worried about when they can go to the bathroom, they're going to be.
Are they really thinking about
what they're really,
box,
thank you.
Amazon.
Thank
but
you.
Anyway.
Thank you.
So, you know, and you want to solicit regular feedback, you know, get feedback from your folks. Is it working? Could it work better? How can we change it? And as I said before, you want to learn from trial and error. Even if you start out doing it one way, get your feedback, evaluate. Are we getting the outcomes we want to get? Great. If not, how do we change it? You know, how do we change it? So the bottom line is that many companies and workers have definitely succeeded with a condensed work week and enjoyed benefits such as increased productivity and more time to pursue personal interests and goals. You know, however, 4-day work schedule may not work for all industries or businesses or even individuals. One of the other things they talked about a possible problem with going to a 4-day work week, some people really do get their social engagement, intellectual engagement, things like that from their work. And so when you decrease that for them, it can sometimes be an issue. And also, I thought this was key in this particular article. going to a 4-day work week is not going to fix your toxic workplace.
I laughed.
I'm like, no, you just be miserable 4 days instead of 5.
You might want to fix that first.
They want to fix that first. Then you can see about the 4-day work week.
I could just get one day.
If I could just get one day away from these people. And so again, as we've talked about, the reevaluation of work has been forced upon the world really by the COVID-19 pandemic. It definitely drove an increased interest in the idea of a 4-day work week. Like I said, we went to 4-day work week before there was a pandemic. Mm-hmm. You know, it wasn't the pandemic that made us go to a 4-day work week. We were glad we had gone to a 4-day work week when the pandemic hit. We were already there, thank you, God. But the COVID-19 pandemic has definitely driven increased interest in the idea of a 4-day work week. But making it the new normal is going to require, you know, a lot more shifts in our cultural, you know, expectations around work, mindset shifts. And that's where these young people are that really de-emphasizes work. Mm-hmm. They're about, can we have some experiences? Can I live my life and enjoy my life
right.
with the people I want to enjoy my life with?
Right.
And not just be stuck in and work
mm-hmm.
till I die.
You know?
Right.
And the things that we thought were important to achieve, like mm-hmm. our little checklist of mm-hmm. doing this, this, and this, mm-hmm. they're like,
that doesn't matter
to me. Thank you.
I'm going to Bali and I'm taking the baby.
I don't, you know, mm-hmm. things like, I don't need a car.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, what do I need a car for?
What I need a car? I don't have to save up. Thank you. I'm not going anywhere. So
again, and also, as we said, as we were looking at this, you need to take a hard look at what work activities can be automated, what can be deprioritized or dropped altogether. And you want to overcome just the overwhelming discomfort and inertia that can come just from trying to make a change. It's like things aren't working. You need to make a change. But thinking about making a change is so uncomfortable for some people that they are stuck, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you don't like where you are, but you're scared to go forward, so you're just like...
Just kind of stay right there.
Just stay right there. That
which
doesn't
isn't
help
good.
Either.
Which
right,
is nice.
Which isn't good. So, again, we kind of fell into a 4-day work week because it wasn't, again, a clear plan of our business. But I think, you know, one of the strengths of our group, the three of us in particular, and then our broader leadership team that we've... developed here at the practice, and then our staff, is that I think we are really getting good at our own individual emotional intelligence, as well as our corporate emotional intelligence as a practice and a business. It's like when you start to recognize that either you're self-aware and you realize that your individual emotional health is suffering, or if you're able to use your own emotional intelligence to look at those around you, look at the workplace and say, something ain't right. We need to look at this, mm-hmm. you know, and then just being able to sit down and say, I'm not doing too good. How are you? And then they say, well, actually, I'm not doing too good either. I'm having trouble doing this. And that's what happened. Yeah. Everybody was saying, yeah. I can't get stuff done either.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. let's see what we could do. And so for us, the answer was a 4-day work week, dropping obstetrics.
Mm-hmm.
And now we can work 10, 15 more years, you know. But we remain flexible because, as we were saying with the conversation to some people a few days ago, you know, will we do XYZ? Will we add an office? Will we do, like, we don't know. You know, because we don't know what the market pressures are going to do. We don't know when the next pandemic may hit. You know, you just don't know what that's going to be. And so you have to remain flexible. You have to remain in communication with your partners, your business partners, with your staff, with your leadership team, so that you can, you know, be nimble and respond to those changes and make well-informed decisions with, you know, all the information that you can gather at the time.
I have to laugh because our newer employees who come from a 5-day work week, when we hire them and then we say it's 4 days, and they're like, huh, what? Mm-hmm.
Can you get everything done?
Like, you know,
am I going to make all my hours? Am I going to do this?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so funny, one of our newer employees, now she's like, how did I live life without my, you know? And every now and then we do have to work a half day on Friday. Mm-hmm. But oh,
it's
dude,
hard.
Oh,
it's hard. It's like, oh my
god.
It's
like, whose idea was this again? Why do we keep doing this? Yeah. Why do we have to do this?
Yeah.
You know, so it's just so funny how it is so easy to adapt.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You get used to it real quick.
Mm-hmm.
When we look back at when we started it, I really thought we had done the 4-day work week a lot longer than we had, because mm-hmm. I was just excited of just having that one day that I can plan stuff on a schedule. Mm-hmm. That to me, because I live by my schedule, to mm-hmm. be able to do this recurrent. For me, it was my hair appointment every Friday and not have to do it, you know, on the half day or mm-hmm. be half asleep or mm-hmm. she wasn't open that day. Mm-hmm. And it was just, if for me, it was one less thing that I had to really think about mm-hmm. because it was already in the schedule.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that for our employees, you know, that's a benefit. Mm-hmm. You know, I know that's for me, it's just knowing that I can do stuff on this day because this is my day.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe I donate the day to my family because that's what happens, mm-hmm. but it's still my day. Mm-hmm. I have control over
the choice.
This.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think that just, mm-hmm. you know.
And you have the flexibility to make the choice.
Right,
right,
right. You know, and that's something that is easy to get used to, which is why mm-hmm. new employees are like, wow, mm-hmm. how did I do that before? Because mm-hmm. that's the way it's always done. And so that's what we've mm-hmm. learned to think that that's normal. Mm-hmm. And it may not be in the future because mm-hmm. obviously things are changing.
Things change. So thank you all for listening to our conversations and some of our ramblings as we've read about in preparation for this episode, 4-day work week and just the history behind how we even got to the 5-day work week. So we're thankful for those of you who tend to listen to us with everything and check us out on all of our social media platforms. Please continue to share us with all of your friends and family and look for us for our next episode to drop real soon. Once again, we thank you for listening. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Green. Take good care.